January the 11th, 1971. The government is to get its first big taste of anarchy, and the house of a cabinet minister is about to be bombed in the biggest of a series of explosions aimed at the heart of the political establishment. Yep. The bomb squad will be formed, and one of the biggest manhunts for years will culminate in one of the longest trials in British legal history. It was the end of an unprecedented period of dissent, born out of a rejection of the Vietnam War and the capitalist system. But for many, change wasn't happening fast enough. And in Europe, disillusionment mixed with radical ideas like anarchy. Some decided that they would have to use guns and bombs to achieve their utopia. In Britain, they called themselves the Angry Brigade. But what lit the fuse? What caused a group of young idealists to try to bomb their way to a better society? This is the story of the Angry Brigade. The events have been reconstructed from official records, interviews with key witnesses, and from an account by Jake Prescott. He, like the others accused in the case, is played by an actor.
It was the morning after. The morning after the big bomb. You know, the one at Robert Carr's house. I bought a paper, and there it was on the front page. I mean, the whole thing. Daily Mirror, Sun, and it was on the TV.
It would be difficult to regard this bomb attack as just a gesture. Most of the ground floor of Mr. Carr's large house is seriously damaged.
It was the bit about the family running from the kitchen, running from the house to the next door neighbour.
My wife and younger daughter and myself were in our sitting room, and there was this loud explosion.
That did it for me. I mean, they were real people. They were real people. I thought it was meant to be symbolic. I was scared, to be entirely truthful about it, because I'd been caught for a lot of things. It was in my mentality that sooner or later I was going to get nicked. So it was about fear, thinking, I'm going to get fucking busted for this, you know? And I wasn't the only one. Everyone went to ground.
Hi, it's Jake. Is Anna there? What about Jim? Is Jim around? Shit. Listen, can you get them to call me ASAP? It's important. What about John? Have you seen John?
This bomb is different. This was the moment when the system said, right, that's enough. Let's get them.
Okay, well, if you do, no, if you do, yeah. I'll be back, I should be back there about 6. Okay, great. Cheers. Bye.
All right, let's just assume that they are the same people. First they call themselves Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, then it's the Wild Bunch, and now they call themselves the Angry Brigade.
I was in the special branch at the time. The CID looked to the special branch to guide them as to where to go in these political situations. And it was purely a political set of outrages, really.
Communique number one. Fascism and oppression will be smashed. Embassies, high pigs, spectacles, judges, well, I suppose that was the Attorney General, property.
To the ordinary CID, it was totally unfamiliar. They were not used to it. And in fact, it was unfamiliar to the country at large because although there was various political protests and demonstrations and all that kind of thing, which did involve a certain amount of violence, it was kind of face-to-face violence and you could see who was doing it. Now, this was sneaky, behind-the-scenes bombing for a motive which sounded political and was political, but it wasn't clear what kind of message they were trying to put across.
Communique number two, December the 8th, success. The Ministry of Employment and Productivity. Now, that was definitely a target.
The driving force, the engine, so to speak, of the squad was Roy Habersham, who was then a chief superintendent. It was known by all and sundry as the bomb squad. And I think as a sergeant, I was probably the most junior man on the squad, if you know what I mean. There may have been There were a handful of PCs as well.
And now this one. Robert Carr got it tonight. We are getting closer. Communication number 4.
As far as the police are concerned, the great moment was the car bomb. That made everything different. I mean, it was as if they sat down and said to themselves, right, well, we've had a few anarchists maybe blowing up a bit of this, a bit of that. Well, we can deal with that, and quite frankly, it's not that important. But these people are going after a minister of the crown. These people are going after the people who issue our orders. That is that. And it is, there was no sand to draw the line in, but whatever you drew a line in 1971, it was drawn, and the whole thing changed.
Who exactly are these people, Creamer? Who are the Angry Brigade?
It's hard to see how I got involved with the Angry Brigade. It just sort of happened, really. First, I met Ian Purdy in Albany Prison on the Isle of Wight. Ian was one of them. He was lost in jail. He'd never been in there before, and I had. So it was a two-way thing, really. I looked after him, and he kind of educated me.
There's no use you, Jake, struggling as an individual. There's more power struggling as part of your class.
He was always talking about revolution this, class struggle that. Didn't seem like a criminal. He was in for throwing a petrol bomb at the Ulster office in London. I thought, that's a great idea. I was intrigued.
System's loaded against people like you. Don't get angry with yourself, man. Get angry with them.
We talked about everything, you know. Drugs, music, politics. Mainly politics.
So what did you do in the mines? Do you ever use explosives?
Yeah, all the time. I grew up with the stuff.
Yeah?
I wasn't there for political reasons at all. I was pretty screwed up, really. Spent a lot of my time in institutions as a kid. I was always fucking incredibly angry and aggressive. I mean, I really was. Hated the cops, hated the lawyers, hated the judges, hated institutions, hated the Home Office, hated the government, hated the Mulhari. That's what it used to be called. Really. And I was hooked on heroin. I mean, I had a right habit, and I was robbing to pay for it. Anyway, I heard about this place, so I scoot around in there and I rob it. Whole lot of stuff, antiques, coin collections, you know, stuff like that. Filled up a couple of bags, and I found a gun. Automatic, loaded. Then, while I was busy doing deals, buying heroin, I get arrested. So I'm in the police station, and I'm trying to lose this gun. And there's these cops, and one of them said, what have you got there? I said, I've fucking got this. And that was it. Possession of a gun, using a firearm to prevent lawful detention. 5.5 years. So I missed a lot of the 1960s. I remember hearing the Big Isle of Wight Festival from my cell, you know? The British Woodstock thing. Instead, I'm reading about American civil rights and stuff, and the Vietnam War, and there were all these groups singing about just about a mile away. I had all this anger boiling up in me and nowhere for it to go. The whole protest thing seemed to be passing me by, so I suppose when Ian came, I was ready for it.
I'd like you to meet some people when you get out. You can get your own back. You can think of it as payback time for the ruling class.
There's something happening here.
A lot of Ian's friends were from Essex University, including Anna, Anne Mendelssohn and Hillary Creek. They were the next ones I really got to know.
Telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Essex was a very new university. It was a strange place because it was stuck in the countryside, about 2 miles away from a garrison town, Colchester, with a lake and some rolling small hills and so on, was stuck these kind of massive concrete constructions in the middle of the Essex countryside. So it was isolated and isolating. It had represented itself as a kind of more radical, more open, more communal sort of place. All those reasons made Essex an obvious place for the spark to ignite, and it did. the framing event of those whole of that whole period is the Vietnam War. The demonstrations against the Vietnam War were very, very important. It was there, it was immediate. It was, you know, a key, and also because the British government was complicit. Why don't you fade away? The people who were Essex were young, largely from pretty middle-class backgrounds, who became fantastically involved in these debates and these discussions and went to the demonstrations. Just talking about my generation. I remember, you know, meeting Alan Mendelssohn and Kevin Purdy and Hilary Creek. They were extremely nice young people. They were idealistic. They were full of kind of hope and energy. They deeply believed that the things they saw around them were wrong. There's nothing cynical about them, nothing grey, nothing violent about them. What there was about them was a tremendous sense of a kind of generalised anger about the way things were and a passionate belief that things should be different.
So we get this done, we should be...
So by the end of the week, we need to know numbers.
Ian was clearly somebody who came with a background in anarchist politics. For the others, their background was not in anarchist politics. Their background was in this extra-parliamentary oppositional student movement. Ian Purdy brought, you know, the other component, I think.
In one way, it was a really bad time to start an interest in revolutionary politics. Everything I was reading about in prison seemed to be happening out there, you know, at Essex and Paris and at Grosvenor Square.
A solid mass of demonstrators tried to storm the embassy. They'd come from all over the country, reinforced by militant left-wing students from Germany, Holland and France.
The Vietnamese people are fighting for freedom and liberty. They've been fighting for nearly 30 years. And they fought against the Japanese and against the French, and now they're fighting against the Americans.
Well, I've just broken through the police lines. The column has just come down the road there. Unfortunately, I've just been hit in the face. There's several smoke bombs. They're through. The first are through now.
Come out of there! Come on, get out of here!
Grosvenor Square was a... Remember, there were two demonstrations, March and October. They were very important because they drew together and encapsulated, they crystallised the opposition to the Vietnam War as the space in which a new movement was growing up, which would then see itself as having things to say about things beyond Vietnam. It became a general movement of criticism and social opposition.
In the last 2 days, Paris has seen the worst street fighting since the liberation in 1944. 30,000 students have fought the tear gas of the riot police with barricades, bricks, paving stones, and Molotov cocktails.
An estimated 250,000 people marched on the US Embassy in Grosvenor Square today in the year's second demonstration against the war in Vietnam. But
the second time around, the police were much better prepared. They limited the square, they controlled things very carefully, and so on. If people did imagine that Grosvenor Square was going to lead to a great student rising, such as there had been in Paris, well, that didn't happen, and maybe some people were disillusioned by it. I mean, presumably, that must at least have been part of the thinking around the Angry Brigade, a kind of frustration with what must have appeared to be, you know, the inability to get beyond limits that were set down by the state, that we could never really get to the embassy, that we could never get to the people who were responsible. Revolution! Once you've decided that the system cannot ever allow freedom or the things you value, the debate then is, well, where do you go? How do you change it? The lack of confidence in the mass movement, the belief that trade unions could too easily be diverted into small changes and reforms rather than revolution and so on, led people to look elsewhere. And where they looked was towards the Third World, to forms of direct action which would enable change to take place in the here and now. And a very influential kind of alternative model was Cuba. What happened in Cuba was that a small, determined, committed group of revolutionaries, rather than waiting for the movement to grow, acted directly themselves against the state, overthrew the state, and that therefore could become the model. In other words, the revolution could be the act of a few who would then, in their turn, spark a wider movement. That was their vision of it. The revolutionaries would act on behalf of and instead of the masses.
Within a couple of years of the Grosvenor Square demonstrations, all started to take off. There'd been a few petrol bombs, whatever, especially against the Franco regime in Spain. But by 1970, the targets were changing. A bomb was planted outside a police station at Paddington Green in London, but it didn't explode. In August, the targets got bigger. The house of one of the top cops in the Met, Sir John Walden, and this time it went off. And about a week later, in Chelsea, Sir Peter Rawlinson, the Attorney General. But none of these were reported. Anyway, I missed all that, the bombs and the demonstrating at Paris and Grosvenor Square. But when I got out of prison, I caught up with Ian in London and into his new world. It was a funny old place, really, the commune at Grosvenor Avenue. A big house, a big Islington house, you know, like 4 or 5 stories, 10 bedrooms, 3 or 4 receptions. Huge.
Remember that guy in that cell, man, the big hard guy, man?
There was a potential for having this wonderful household with all sorts of caring and community and getting to know your neighbours and whatever, you know? And people were working out about having relationships, trying to work them out just like that, there and then. Like, on what sort of basis did you own a room? So the upshot was, you didn't have a room. So you came home at night, you found out where you were sleeping, and then who you were sleeping with. Was it fun? Nah, I can't say it was, really. It was a bit too serious.
I don't want anyone misinterpreting what I'm talking about here. I'm talking about painting a face.
To fight, to prove I'm right.
The communes were so very attractive, basically to middle-class young people, because they were breaking out of what they saw the straitjacket of their middle-class family lives, and they were in rebellion.
One can't underestimate the fact that for most of the 60s, we were still living in the 50s. If you look at what the counterculture was preaching, I suppose the neatest thing is personal freedoms. The personal freedom to take drugs, the personal freedom for a girl, for a woman to have an abortion, the personal freedoms to arrange your life as you wish to arrange it, without interference from on high.
It used to bother me that you'd have these endless parties going on in any of these squats that you went to. Loads and loads of drugs, particularly marijuana in those days. And not to agree to sleep with somebody who'd asked you to sleep with, particularly from the women's side, was an extremely difficult position for a woman, particularly now that we had the pill. Because sexual license, the idea was that women had to express themselves sexually in order to be liberated. I thought they were very sad places. The idea that they would celebrate this wonderful way of living together and sharing, well, it isn't what you felt when you went in there. I just remember being terribly put off by the dankness and the filthiness of it.
I'm more concerned about cleaning up society than cleaning up this room. I mean, this is just, you know, symptomatic of something much bigger, isn't it?
The idea that you should clean up was bourgeois. The whole thing, anything you did to put any structure into anything was considered bourgeois and you shouldn't be doing it. And I remember once on a very hot summer's day, because we weren't allowed to use deodorants, that was capitalist. I said, well, is it now politics to smell?
You don't understand, this is just a start. The point is, the mess is on the carpet of the world, that's what I'm saying.
Well, that's one mate. Let's go. That was just stupid. That was just wrong.
But I'm being serious.
That's good.
I'm being serious. You're talking about what's happening in France, and I'm asking you why it's not happening here. Okay, you know what I'm talking about.
I just thought it was a very dangerous time. And I thought that the early 70s was the closest that I ever thought of England reaching anarchy.
One mustn't underestimate the genuine anger among even the hippies, because whatever the realities were, the establishment, the straight world, took us very seriously and of course responded in many cases very aggressively, particularly to the concept of drug taking. Probably a lot of those hippies would have been probably very happy to be left alone and get on with their love and peace. Didn't happen that way. They weren't allowed to do it. So when the bombs start going off, there's a lot of revolutionary groupieism by the countercultural press. The Angry Brigade were getting out there, as it were, in the streets and doing it, whereas the New Left Review, God bless them, were not.
When I arrived in London, there was a definite air of something changing. To some extent, the Angry Brigade had already formed when I came out. I don't mean it was in existence, not as an organisation. I mean, there was no organisation. But the people, they were already disillusioned, if you like. And although they enjoyed drugs and they enjoyed the benefits, if you like, of that period, you know, easy relationships, sexual freedom, whatever, all that sort of stuff, there was also this feeling that the hippie days were over. Bader and Meinhof were already on the go. Ireland was changing, you know. It was the civil rights marches. It was almost like a statement for a lot of people that this was the end of that kind of period that you wouldn't get. You know, by marching in the street, you wouldn't get what you wanted. You wouldn't get better housing. You wouldn't get non-sectarian schools. You wouldn't get fairness.
Two men have died in rioting in Belfast after a big roundup of suspects this morning, which was followed by an official announcement that there's to be internment. Police say that more than 300 people have been arrested, and the Prime Minister has announced that internment orders may be served on them.
I mean, the idea that there was a whole lot of people in the house that were all committed to the same thing, that's the wrong impression. There were actually a lot of different things going on in the house, like the feminism, the Miss World contest, the politics and that, you know.
Shame on you all! You're degrading yourself!
Flower bombs, smoke bombs, disruption, big TV thing, well thought out, publicity, the whole thing.
I want to tell you, anybody that would try to break up an affair as wonderful as this have got to be on some kind of dope, ladies and gentlemen, believe me.
Meanwhile, one of the Angry Brigades under the BBC van outside, bombing it. That didn't go down too well.
A BBC outside broadcast van at the Miss World contest was damaged. A group of young men were seen running away after the explosion at about 2 o'clock in the morning.
Anyway, I suppose I'd been out of prison for about 4 months when I thought, I'll walk around and see some friends who lived in Notting Hill. I got to the corner of the road and I looked and I changed my mind. I thought, I'll go and visit someone else first. What I didn't know is there were two cops sitting in a car. They saw me change my mind, thought that I'd spotted them. They ran after me. I heard these feet. Anyway, they find a bit dope, get my address book, everybody's addresses in it, charged with possession of stolen checkbooks, blah, 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 end up remanded in Brixton. You know, it was like a people's group. They lived in this kind of commune. It was brilliant. I'd never seen nothing like it. I mean, I come from Fife, you know, little place in Scotland. And to walk into that, and the girls, man, oh man, Jesus. If you're like me, then it's not that easy keeping your mouth shut in prison. Everyone wants to know why you're in there and what you've done. So you always blag it up. You have to brag, you know, spin a fanny or two. They were there for the cause, man. Seeing all that, man, for all that peace and love, man, we were pretty angry. Called ourselves the Angry Brigade.
Hey. Yeah. Yeah, hello. Yep.
Did he now? Very interesting. Yeah. Uh-huh. Did he mention any bombs? Yeah.
There's a few of us. Ian, Anna. Oh, they were good times, man. Good times. For the cause.
For the what?
For the cause.
What cause?
We do like politicians, pigs. The car bombing. Do you know about the car bombing?
Me and my big mouth. We started talking about Grosvenor Avenue and whatever, and the car bombing.
I mean, we don't look like your normal terrorists, you know what I mean? We were all like, yeah, free love.
I mean, I was making a lot of it up. But you should never trust cons. And they went to the cops and said there was a guy in our cell who's something to do with the bombing.
Who expected a bunch of fucking middle-class hippies to be fucking terrorising the nation, man? Well, you fucking did all right, man.
Apart from at the commune, we also used to meet at this flat above a Jewish butcher shop in Stamford Hill. Five of us used to spend a lot of time there. Mainly me, Anna and Hillary. But also two guys from Cambridge, John Barker and Jim Greenfield.
I'm fine, yeah.
Jim was kind of foxy. He didn't say a great deal, but he was a doer. John was a thinker. He spent a lot of time translating the works of French anarchists. I used to read some of them, but I was lost completely. 1.5 paragraphs is about as much as I ever got through. My God, your eyes just glaze over and your brain goes frozen.
I've just got to complete this paragraph here, then I'll be finished.
You can't copy it straight from the book.
I can't copy it.
No, it looks as though you are.
So, Anna, do you think that's all right?
No, I'm going to change the last bit.
OK.
Do you mind?
No, not at all.
No, it's the crimes. That's really how we met, through fraud and robbery and burglaries and stuff like that. That's how we lived. I mean, we didn't have jobs or anything like that. And that was really my first entry into the Angry Brigade. It wasn't like, come and join the revolution now. It was like, fancy nipping down the road and getting a few hundred quid, you know? Why was I involved? Well, quite frankly, I saw it as an evolutionary move in my criminal behaviour. Remember, I'd gone in as a heroin addict holding up a police station and stuff like that. The flat in Stamford Hill was really crummy, but that was where we planned the next targets, the next political action.
The second paragraph down.
It was private, away from Grosvenor Avenue. No one knew about it, but it was there we divvied out the proceeds of the crimes, all the forgeries, all the documents, all the stolen checkbooks, all that sort of stuff. There was lots of that about, you know, just piled in a corner, not hidden or anything, but it was there.
Listen, Jim, you know what we were talking about the other day there? I'm going to need some money over the next couple of days. Get that sorted. I'm going to need a couple of hundred anyway.
A couple of hundred?
Yeah. Just things to get. Good man, cheers.
That should be nice, shouldn't it?
Yeah, I'll get that sorted.
You keep us posted about it, yeah?
Mm-hmm. OK. I ain't going to run the country, don't worry about it. You know what I mean?
But the thing is, none of us really knew what was happening. There were loads of people involved, some more, some less. Because loads of people thought like we did. And often the first you knew about any of the bombings or those communiques was when you read about it in the papers the next day.
It seems to me the key things to be understood about this period, which the Angry Brigade in some ways symbolises or represents, it is that they were not, you know, a bunch of nutcases who arrived in a spaceship, that they were part of a living movement, a real movement, with a belief that, in a way, change was urgent and necessary. You know, to be a student revolutionary was to identify with the oppressed, with the fighters, with the anti-imperialists, with the anti-colonialists. You were a revolutionary going for the big prize. And the problem was there was no real sense of how you got from here to there. You know, what, how do you build a movement?
The Angry Brigade.
Do you build a movement, or do you create, as Guevara had suggested, a core of determined, committed, morally incorruptible people who will make the revolution on behalf of the masses. That idea, you know, began to spread.
You should still be typing.
And the inevitable consequence of taking on this kind of political action is that you necessarily become inward-looking, careful, closed, secretive, and that's the irony, that's the contradiction. In the name of the masses, you insulate yourself from the masses.
I mean, things got heavy. Really heavy. And they got heavier.
After a bomb at the Department of Employment and Productivity, the communique said it was part of a planned series of attacks on government and capitalist property.
The second bomb, which went off several minutes after the first, blew a policeman off his feet as he arrived in answer to emergency calls. And if anyone had been standing in the kitchen, they might well have been killed.
Have you any idea what kind of people would have perpetrated this?
No idea at all.
What I didn't know at that point was something very weird was about to happen. Well, weird for me anyway. I'm at the magistrate's court to have my case considered, and the prosecutor says,
"The Crown is not
we're not opposing bail." I mean, I didn't even ask for it. The lawyer hadn't even asked for it. I just thought, wow, I'd never had bail in my fucking life. I was on parole when I'd been arrested. I should have been straight back to jail. But I should have guessed I was being set up. Apparently they had cars everywhere around Grosvenor Avenue. Backside, foreside, end of the road. But I never spotted a thing. I think I was the real big break. Anyway, about a week after I'm let out, I've got a pocket full of amphetamines, three quarters of an ounce of dope in my jacket, and I'm off to the pub to get a pint down me. Suddenly we're surrounded. Police come around. A guy comes over to me, he's got a gun. "Jake Prescott," he says, "will you come with me?" I knew the fucking game was up, and I said, "but can I finish my pint?" Typical Scott. They took us to Barnet. That's where Habersham was sitting waiting. So that was it. The interviews, Jesus. Well, I could hardly stop talking. I talked a lot of shite, you know, and I mentioned one person's name in the interview that I shouldn't have done, you know. Thought I was being clever, you know, and he was talking to me about checks. I was quite happy to talk about checks and fraud and stuff like that. You're not trying to pin that on me, are you?
Like it or not, it was kiting checks, a boring, normal, classical criminal act. Nothing to do with revolution, nothing to do with guns, nothing to do with bombs, nothing to do with hideaways in the Stoke Newington, but just stealing checkbooks. That's what brought them low.
Is this your address book?
I can see what you're getting at.
Jake Prescott was able to provide first names and descriptions and that kind of thing of the sort of people he'd been mixing with. And lo and behold, these are the same people that were involved in the check fraud squad. So that this was the way it went.
Immediately following the bombing, letters were sent to various newspapers. Did you have anything to do with that?
I never wrote letters to newspapers or anything.
The letters were contained in envelopes. And according to a handwriting expert who compared these with examples of your handwriting, you wrote those addresses.
Not me. I didn't write these.
You have a good look yourself. It's obvious even to an untutored eye that you wrote them.
Well, I might have written them, but I didn't know what for. You can't prove from that I did the bombing.
When you were on remand in Brixton prison recently, you were in a cell for some days with two other men. I'm told that in the course of conversation with these two men, you not only admitted having done the car bombing with another man and two girls, but you also admitted being involved in the bombing of the Department of Employment in St James's Square on the night of the 8th of December last year, and the bombing of the BBC television vehicle the night before the Miss World contest.
You must be joking. I never said anything of the sort. You can't prove that I did.
Not only did you admit that you did the car bombing, but you described exactly what happened. You told the girl who was with you to place her bomb beside the car's front door, whilst the other girl went round the back of Carr's house to look for his motor car in order to place a bomb beneath that. She came back round the front of the house saying she couldn't find the car round the back of the house, and how she was then told to put her bomb beside a servant's door alongside the other one.
This is fantastic. They're making it all up.
Well, how do you account for such an accurate description? Did you have such conversations with these men?
Perhaps I did. But I was only spinning them a fanny. I wouldn't do a bombing that's worth life imprisonment.
Have you got anything to tell us?
I know that Ian Purdy knows who did the bombing.
The truth is that although the car bombing meant that a line had been drawn, the Angry Brigade had crossed it, and it was important that that chase should be extremely hard now, they weren't really getting that much nearer until Prescott and Purdy get busted.
Let me say at once that I'm not in the least interested in the political aspect of this matter, other than the extent to which it concerns the motive behind these bombings.
That's a lot of balls for a start. You're going to fit me up because I'm an anarchist, same as you've done with Jake Prescott.
I believe that you are in touch, are you not, with anarchists in both Birmingham and Manchester?
You know very well I am. Why ask?
You really are scraping up the shit to sling at me, aren't you?
One of the things the police had to struggle against was that they really didn't know what they were up against. They didn't understand the counterculture, be they the hippies or be they the brigade. They didn't understand it. It was meaningless to them. They couldn't understand this world which was running in parallel to their own, that actually, well, not exactly despised, but had no time for the world in which, if presumably, if you're a special branch man, if you're a policeman, what you believe in, your assumptions. Here was this world which just didn't have any time for it.
Look, do you often sit here talking to yourself? If you think I did it, why don't you charge me?
Another explosion and an anonymous telephone call to a news agency. The caller, a woman, said she was a member of the Angry Brigade. She said, "We have just got Fords and we will do the rest later."
Whoever did it must have been a maniac, because the whole foundation of that building would have fallen down. I mean, it's 14 stories, it could have come over all these houses.
So they get more and more isolated and out on a limb. I'm sitting in jail saying, for Christ's sake, man, give yourself a break. Turn it in, have a break, go on holiday, go to Spain, go to the seaside, you know.
Home Office explosive experts are looking for possible fragments of the bomb which might tell them how it was made and what of.
I'm sitting here, you know. They're going to kill me. The screws are going to kill me every time a bomb goes off. But they couldn't stop. They were caught up in it.
I went to my bedroom window and then I saw the smoke and the glass falling.
Although they blasted out the front door of my wine stocks, the wine stocks seemed to survive, actually, so that's something.
It was inevitable they were going to get busted. We were just kind of waiting for the day, really.
The officers arrived at Elmhurst Road, and the people that were, four people in the flat, were in an upstairs room. So they were able to surprise them. When they looked around, they found all the detonators and all that kind of thing. Now, I wasn't personally there, but they brought it all back to the yard, and it was horrendous.
They pulled out the guns from under the bed, and the cop said to Hillary and John, Jim and Anna were out of the room. He says, "Whose are these?" And they looked at each other. John and Hillary says, "They're the Angry Brigades."
The police swoop followed intense investigations carried out in great secrecy over the last 48 hours. Here in Amherst Road, Stoke Newington, four detectives arrived in a van and went to the top floor flat in that house over there.
There was four of them.
Did the police take anything else?
Well, afterwards, I think they took away something that looked like suitcases.
There's things to blow stuff up. There's documents like you've never seen. There's all sorts of things. Revolutionary, incendiary stuff.
If you overlook the fact that I got myself nicked by talking in the prison, what certainly ruined my trial was the four people being arrested and finding all that stuff just a few weeks before it began. The whole first week of the trial was just full of what came out of Amherst Road. Oh yeah, I was a goner.
The principal offence with which the two men are charged is the bombing of the house which belongs to the Employment Minister, Mr. Robert Carr. But the prosecution also alleges that Prescott and Purdy, or their fellow conspirators, had been concerned in five other similar incidents.
Security at the Old Bailey has been intensified throughout the day. People entering the court with parcels or briefcases have had them searched, and entrance to the main body of number 2 court, where this trial's taking place, has been by ticket only. Mr. John Matthew, who's prosecuting, said the allegation is that these two young men, self-styled revolutionaries and anarchists, sought to promulgate their ideals in acts of violence by causing serious explosions aimed at damaging the property of those they consider to be their political enemies.
Now that I am allowed to speak, I reject the role of accused. I brought about my own downfall, really. I'd already admitted writing the envelopes, and the weight of the evidence was very much against me. I dare to tell the truth. Whereas with Ian, it was purely some notebooks that he had been writing since I got arrested, plus association, shared ideas and stuff like that, all that crap. I am being tried purely and simply for my own political views. So I got 15 years for conspiracy to cause explosions. He got off. But our trial was nothing compared to the trial to come. Not only were the four people who were arrested at Amherst Road with all the guns and gelatinite and stuff, but four others. Now they were called the Stoke Newington Eight. They had loads of people outside to defend them. The defence committee is coming out of their ears.
Anyone watching this would have said this was a political trial because the issues were political. The issues were the attitudes of people towards the state. And so, in that sense, it was the alternative politics that had led to these bombings that was on trial.
There was Jim, John, Anna and Hilary, all from Amherst Road. Stuart Christie, who'd been involved in action against Franco's regime. Chris Bott, he'd been at Essex. And Katie McLean and Angie Weir, two women's lovers had met at the commune.
The allegation in this case is that these defendants, calling themselves revolutionaries and anarchists...
Basically, the four from Amherst Road were charged with possession of all the arms and the explosives they found at their flat. Jim and Anna were also facing attempted bombing charges, but everyone was up for conspiracy to cause explosions.
If they shared the alternative politics and if they had documents in their flat that showed that they shared the politics, it was more likely that they would be part of the conspiracy. And a lot of the prosecution was conducted on that basis.
Then there were the bombs that never went off. That left a lot of clues as to how the bombs were made. There were a few fingerprints on newspapers and some envelopes. And handwriting, yeah. A lot of the rest was about handwriting and plans that people had drawn and things like that.
Members of the jury, there are 25 bombings alleged as part of the conspiracy count. Apart from three of those, the police and the prosecution haven't got a clue who planted them.
I represented Jim Greenfield, and the other three people from Amherst Road decided to represent themselves. It was an important factor in this trial because the three people were very articulate, they were very intelligent, bright, and they asked very good questions in cross-examination. And I think the jury got a fairly good idea of what kind of people they were.
The prosecution has produced against me the few lines they say I wrote for the Angry Brigade Moonlighter Cell communique. I admit, it was printed at the duplicator found at Amherst Road. But there is no evidence to suggest that the cell communique was in any way connected to a bombing. Many people were very angry at the British government's introduction of internment without trial in Northern Ireland. I helped produce a statement against this because of my deep feelings. That meant more to me than the whys and wherefores of the politics of the Angry Brigade.
I think what they wanted to do was to put forward their views that they belong to the same alternative politics, but didn't actually share the actual beliefs of the bombers. They didn't think it was necessary to bomb. That was part of their defence.
And here they were, two people in your flat, claiming that they wanted to make a statement on behalf of the Angry Brigade?
Yes.
Did you not show them the door?
No.
Why not?
I've told you how I felt about internment.
These two people were intimately connected with the Angry Brigade.
That wasn't obvious, no.
Oh, Miss Mendelssohn, are you really saying that?
I did not know how they were connected with the Angry Brigade.
Of course you didn't know the exact details. But you realised who they were?
They said they wanted to come round and put out a statement from the Angry Brigade on internment. That is what I knew.
And I suppose you asked them. The Angry Brigade are the people who've done all these bombings. Didn't you ask them?
The question I asked them about it was, is this connected with a bombing? They said no. I read it and I didn't agree with some of the statements at the end.
We will come to that.
Objection. She is trying to answer the question.
The central part of the defence was that the very large amount of guns and ammunition found in the flat at Amherst Road had been planted by the police, and that was their fundamental defence.
None of us living at Amherst Road have ever denied contact with people who said they were the Angry Brigade. We knew a lot of people whom the police were already investigating about the bombings. We were obvious targets for a plant because of this.
I think that most of the guns and the detonators and the rest of the ammunition fitted into or were able to fit into, I can't remember whether it was one or two carrier holders, and so they said they'd been brought in by the police.
So you're saying that Mendelssohn and Greenfield were taken down and that we were kept there?
Yes, that is true.
That is a lie, Mr. Davis.
It is not, Mr. Barker.
Police credibility at that time was actually quite low. There'd been lots of minor cases where police had been planting cannabis in people and so forth. And, you know, people were running plant defences and were succeeding on them.
No, I'm telling the truth, Mr. Davis. After about 6 or 7 minutes after you first entered the house, it is only then that Jim and Anna are taken down the stairs. And then some other officers take us down, that's Hillary and myself, without charging us at anything. Only then are we taken down the stairs.
You couldn't make allegations of that kind unless there was already the beginnings, at least, of a culture of disbelief in the integrity of police evidence.
I put it to you, Mr. Davis, that what really happened was that Hillary and I were brought back about 5 or 6 minutes later, after we had been taken down, and then you begin to find things with the speed of a silent film, all in the space of about 3 minutes.
Utterly untrue. We found the property in your presence, in that room, before you were taken away.
That is not true, Mr. Davis.
They had to make a defence of some sort, and quite often, if they can't think of anything else, they say, well, the police planted it. And you get isolated cases of police officers doing things they shouldn't do, but not a whole team.
I remember reading that there were loads of people walking around London with badges on saying, I'm a member of the Angry Brigade. See, this is idea conspiracy. I mean, it's a false thing. I mean, if you're saying that people have got shared ideas and shared thoughts and that makes a conspiracy, it means any political thought that doesn't agree with the people that are in power must be a conspiracy.
Is it right that at the time when the bomb was placed in the Department of Employment and Productivity around the 9th of December, this was the time of enormous protest against the Industrial Relations Bill?
That is true.
And it is right that on the 8th of December, the day before, that the police were notified that 50,000 members of the trade union movement would be holding a march and demonstration against the bill.
The ambit of the conspiracy was never made clear. I mean, the nucleus of it was the four main defendants. I mean, that, but how far the ripple effect of this went, it was completely unclear. I mean, they quite clearly included as Angry Brigade bombings, bombings which had absolutely nothing to do with the Angry Brigade, if there was such a body.
Going to the next explosion, number 18, which was the one at Mr. Carr's house on the 12th of January 1971. Is it right that the day that the bomb went off was another day of protest against the Industrial Relations Bill?
Yes, that is correct.
You see, wouldn't it be right, Commander Bond, that any member of those between 50 and 70,000 people took part in those demonstrations of protest would have had a motive to place bombs in the Department of Employment and Productivity or Mr. Carr's house?
In the end, the judge threw out many of the bombings, leaving in effect just the possession and the conspiracy charges. But he told the jury, now it only took a wink and a nod to affect the conspiracy.
If you convict us, we are not going to change. We will still be who we are, what we believe. I believe the people in this dock with me are working towards a happier, more peaceful world. That is who we are. It is your decision.
You get this awful feeling that it was like a lottery in that jury room. They weren't too sure. They weren't by any means as 100% behind the police and the special branch and the kind of evidence, the prosecution evidence, as they might have been, say, a decade before.
The courtroom was tense and packed when the jury returned. It was thought possible that they might have come to an early verdict. There was a notable relaxation of the tension when the judge announced that he'd been asked by the jury to review some of the evidence relating to a raid on Amherst Road when the police claimed that they found 33 sticks of gelignite there.
I think that jury were very aware that these were not just a bunch of absurd people who were dangerous and so on and so forth, that there was something there, they had something to say, they may have and undoubtedly gone about it the wrong way with bombs or so, but they did not just want to crush them.
The jury then retired and returned only briefly at 5 o'clock this evening before being taken away to their secret hotel. An early verdict was never seriously expected in a case like this, which has gone on for 6 months.
sentencing James Greenfield, John Barker, Anne Mendelssohn, and Hillary Creek, all in their early 20s, Mr. Justice James said, "I'm sorry to see such intelligent and educated people in your situation. Undoubtedly, a warped understanding of sociology has brought you to the state in which you are." Four others were acquitted after the trial, in which the jury took 52 hours to reach the majority verdicts.
The Stoke Newington 8 were now down to 5, including me, and we were facing 10 years each. I knew the men would be all right, but the women, I thought, Jesus, 10 years in Holloway. I was really shocked about that, because the women's prisons are just awful. After the verdicts, the papers made a fuss and all that, calling us the Big Head Brigade. But there were demonstrations of support, even outside the prison. At least we didn't feel alone. And that was it, really. Well, more or less. It wasn't, of course. See, there were 5 in prison now, but there were more than 5 of us still out there, you know, who were angry.
You do get the feeling that there are concentric circles of people who really, when push comes to shove, were the Angry Brigade. And I think those concentric circles are probably 20 people or maybe 30 people or maybe more. Those who went to prison, well, they were the unlucky ones. The main effect of the Angry Brigade was not to encourage the revolution, but was actually to frighten people. One cannot underestimate the response of the state. If you pull the lion's tail hard enough, he will lash out with one of his extremely sharp clawed paws, and he will get you. We don't get fooled again.
It's very easy to consign these people and their ideas to a kind of moment in the past, now well forgotten, but I think it's worth looking around and saying that not only are these ideas not dead, not only is that sense of anger and rejection of capitalism and the way it functions worldwide, not only is that feeling not dead, but it has been rediscovered by a whole new generation who, even as we speak, are demonstrating in their tens and hundreds of thousands across the world. Maybe the Angry Brigade has gone, but the spirit that informed it has certainly not disappeared.
The Angry Brigade mattered for me, obviously on a personal level, because it was totally liberating experience for me. I wouldn't be where I am today without, you know, having been a member of the Angry Brigade. Of course, I regret some of the activities and some of the bombing, but you know, the Angry Brigade punctured the consumerist society, and you know, I think the questions are still relevant today, even more so today. Just that, you know, we're all too old to be doing the same thing again.